This is KJEM, KJEM Radio, and we are on the air. I'm Craig Phillips.
And I'm Amy Rhodes. We are your hosts, and we want to welcome you to our second episode of The Truly Outrageous World of STEM right here on KJEM Radio.
This week, we'll begin our show analysis on the debut episode of GEM, The Beginning. We will break down each of the three acts and give our take on how we see the show.
And remember that you can participate anytime during the show by calling. Our number is 1-724-444-7444. And our call ID is 93860.
That's right. So, the very first episode of GEM, well, it's called The Beginning. Basically, GEM, going back a little bit, GEM started as a 7-minute block in the Super Sunday show, which ran for about a year. And what it basically was 6 to 7 minute segment shows that starred Bigfoot and the Muscle Machines, as well as robotics and humanoids. Now, these are really obscure cartoons that were very, very short-lived. One of the things about The Beginning was the characters weren't really all that defined. What I mean is that in the very first scene, you see Aja, and she's playing with a drumstick, and yet she was not necessarily a drummer. They had not nailed down what instrument she was going to play. However, you do see in the music video that she actually plays a guitar. The episode itself was written by show creator Christy Marks, who I think is one of the more brilliant writers on the show and absolutely phenomenal. The very first episode that you see is what has become known as the movie. There's actually 5 parts to this show. And this is obviously the first one, and it was essentially a miniseries. I wouldn't really call it a movie, just more of a miniseries. What we're going to talk about here is the first act of the series. In the first act, we have a kind of a, like, they're already successful. GEM and the Holograms is already successful. And they are, you know, kind of being introduced one by one. They come around in their car outside of the gig.
Did you notice, though, when they're being introduced in that first scene that it's Misfits music being played in the background?
And it's a song that actually has not been introduced yet.
That's
so
right.
We get
Out of My Way, and it was playing in the background. It's like, what a way to welcome GEM and the Holograms. Play Misfits music.
Yeah, that's one thing I thought that was really interesting, and why they did that, I don't know, but in some ways, foreshadowing a Misfit song is very interesting, in my opinion. I really don't know what to even say about that. I think that if GEM really heard that, she'd be like a little offended by that. But who knows? So what you get with the first little bit is the introduction of the characters. You hear the whole fans cheering for each one of them as they come out of the car, out of the Rockin' Roadster, I should say. So you get kind of the future of what was to become. Then you end up with a flashback. And what we hear is Jerrica reminiscing about how it all began. And it began with the death of her father, the unexpected death, I should say, of her father, Emmett Benton. Now, you have to kind of go back a little bit in history to really understand what happened, but they don't really tell you that he died until episode, I don't even know what episode number it is, but it's out of the past.
Out of the past. Yeah,
so that's in season 3,
episodes.
Part 2. And one of the things that you find out is that, you know, he was slowing down in age, and, you know, I think the GEM community kind of agrees that he, I think, had cancer of some type.
Yeah, he
and
was
so,
sick for a while, and he hid it from the kids. I'm not sure why. He didn't tell them he was sick, and then he passed away.
You know, one of the things that happened was that you don't really get a sense of, you know, why. And then they also don't really even tell you about Jackie Benton, who was their mother. You never really hear about her until much, much later in the series. And so there was a lot of, I think, you know, more or less just kind of pivotal focusing on GEM and the Holograms and focusing on their kind of their career. So we're kind of introduced in the funeral. It's raining, it's pouring out, and you know, everybody's in black, and everybody's really sad, and, you know, obviously you can see the Starlight Girls in the background, and you see Eric Raymond kind of sliming his way up to Jerrica. And
he is bucking up. He is trying to act like a good guy, and, I mean, I don't even remember what my first impression was of him, but, yeah, he's all trying to, oh, if you need anything, oh, I'll be there for you, and, you know, Rio,
exactly.
Of course, knows he's a jerk, and he's like, eh, no.
That's very true. That's very true. One of the things that you do see also is kind of how angry Rio gets. And Rio is Jerrica's boyfriend and longtime boyfriend since I think junior high school. He's kind of just telling Eric to back off, and Eric's like, "I'm really sorry about what happened," and Rio's like, kind of giving him like the brush off, like, "We'll be fine, she'll be fine, back off, whatever." And so then there's, then they kind of push forward a little bit and go to Starlight House, so you're introduced to, kind of that world. And basically, the girls were with an inheritance. I'm talking Jerrica and Kimber, the sisters of Ceres, and they inherited the Starlight House, which was a foster home for girls, and then their parents' music company called Starlight Music.
Well,
And
Jerrica and Eric bought Starlight Music half and half. Jerrica and Kimber were left the house, just to make that clear.
okay, well, again, that's one of the things that you don't really learn about right away. And then, of course, with the whole Starlight world, which is kind of funny how that's like pretty much everything that Emmett Benton owned, he called it Starlight for some reason or another. They end up needing money to fund Starlight House because they're running short on funds and they need to, pay for the food and whatever. So Jerrica decides she's going to go running over to Starlight Music to get money. Lo and behold, guess who's sitting behind her father's desk? Eric Raymond, Mr. Evil. And basically telling her to take a hike, and that he wants to bring in more talent, better talent, in fact, a band like the Misfits. And then we're introduced to the Misfits,
Yeah, they're ready to burst in the door with their song and show off.
That's right, absolutely. And, with that, you have to wonder, first of all, I have to say this comment. Why they came in on guitar-shaped motorcycles is just absolutely, I can't figure that one out. I mean, it's kind of a
Oh,
cool
but
entrance, but.
since Pizzazz was rich, I figure she had Daddy buy her motorcycles and, because she wanted them.
That's
Just
true, that's true.
because.
Before we continue, actually, we're going to take our first call and go ahead from South Carolina. You're on the air.
Yeah, hello. This is Kenny,
Hey,
and
Kenny, what's going on?
I'm on Facebook right now listening to you guys talk about the first episode of KJEM. And one of the things I like about the show that they had all these deep stories of the band members and stuff.
Yeah, they really
Really,
did dive into the personalities of the characters.
my favorite in the series was Kimber.
Awesome.
She was all emotional, She had this habit of pouting at some instances. I guess the death of her father and her mother really affected her, just like it did Jerrica.
Right.
Right.
We
But you
covered
don't
the
really
same.
see it until you don't really see it, Kenny, until much later in the series, that it really, really affected her. The episode that we'll be talking about in the future is Father's Day. We really, really do see that. And
I remember that episode up.
yeah.
When Class goes to see her father and Video goes to see her
Exactly.
father.
Exactly.
Yeah, that was. We'll talk about
And
that one later.
it covers a lot of things. Like, we get a mention of how Pizzazz, the way that Pizzazz acts.
Oh, I
Right,
love
right.
that. I loved it
Her
when they
mother,
brought that up.
Exactly.
Right. It was
Yeah, it
nuts.
gave a reason for her to be such a brat, I guess.
Exactly,
Yeah.
exactly. Well, hey, thanks, Kenny, for calling in. I really appreciate that. Nice to hear from you, by the way. So basically, in the first act, the whole thing with Jem and the Holograms introductions and the Misfits introductions, we have one more character that's introduced, and I think it's kind of one of the coolest ways they ever did it. They make their way back to Starlight House, and first I have a couple of comments about when they go back to Starlight House. One of the first things that you see on Jerrica's desk is what? You see the Gemstar earrings box. Okay,
Right,
now
right.
it says a big thing of Jerrica's name right on it. Well, my question is, first of all, why is that even in that scene at this point? Because Kimber's line right after that is, "Oh, Jerrica, I forgot this came for you." In my opinion, wouldn't Jerrica have seen it? It's like right in her face. It's sitting there, right in her face. It is one of
Somebody
the most.
brought it in and put it there, and I don't know. I don't know why she didn't see it, but more what I would think about is why did somebody send her this? And we find out later, yes, it was her father that had it sent to her. And he meant it as a birthday present because he died right before her birthday, June 1st. So I mean, there's a reason, but we don't find that out at that point. We're just like, okay, somebody sent her a package, you know. I think she assumed it was from Rio.
What we're seeing is a lot of exposition, and this is one of the things that writers hate. Exposition is when basically you're doing every bit of character analysis. You're looking at your characters. You're looking at your introductions. It's all the really slow stuff that doesn't, you know, unfortunately, you have to do in that world. So, of course, you know, Kimber says, oh, you know, these came for you. Jerrica opens up the box, and voila, what does she see there? The Gemstar earrings. What she doesn't know, of course, is going to be revealed, you know, in a few seconds here, and that, of course, is Synergy. And now Synergy is a really cool character, I have to admit. She is known as the ultimate audio and visual computer system ever built. In fact, she's so advanced that if it ever fell into the wrong hands, it could create absolute chaos. Synergy basically introduces herself as soon as Jerrica puts on the earrings. And, you know, in a little dramatic feature, there's a crash of thunder and the window or the shutters start to hit the house from the wind. And all of a sudden you see this, you know, this holographic image of Synergy, who's got a very, like, plain, purplish type of look. She has, like, no pupils in her eyes, so you never know who she's looking at. So you're introduced to Synergy, and she essentially says before the first act break, you know, Jerrica, I've come for you. And that's got to be one of the creepiest things.
You don't know why this thing is here. That had to freak them out, because you don't know if she's good or bad or why she's there in that moment.
Exactly.
Commercial break.
Exactly, and that's your first commercial break. So, you know, when we actually come back to the actual show, Jerrica's invited along with Aja and Shayna, which, you know, we have to mention, they actually did see Synergy. All of them saw them. They were all in the room.
They were all there.
Yeah, and I will say this: I firmly, firmly believe that Aja and Shayna were adopted because they were the first two Starlight girls.
The Benton family, yeah.
And so there was no reason to keep them out of the loop. So we find that Synergy's leading them towards Starlight Movie Theater, again, something else that Emma Benton owned, and, you know, basically said, hey, you know what, come and check out who I am. And I had to really think about this for a second here. Would you actually believe a computer system? I mean, would you honestly believe that a computer system could actually do that?
I would be hesitant. I wouldn't know what to think.
Yeah, exactly. And then when they actually get to the Starlight Theater, the big movie screen is sitting on top of this, like, brick wall, right? And all of a sudden, they're like, you know, she's being told, Jerrica's being told, drive forward. Or, I'm sorry, Aja's being told to drive forward. And she's like, you know what? I'm not crazy enough to go through that wall.
I'm not that crazy.
Exactly. And so what do we get? Well, we end up getting that she's like, just go ahead and do it. You know, and that's, of course, Jerrica's words. I've got a hunch, you know. And I'm like, okay, that's supposed to be, like, the most convincing thing in the world.
Yeah.
So basically, you end up going through their world. What I mean by their world is you're basically in the van with them, and you're going through this wall, and you're like, okay, that's a holographic wall. And then they're totally blown away by this ginormous computer, which, funnily enough, actually has synthesizer keyboard throughout it. Now, I know that she's supposed to be a synthesizer per se, but, you know, to me, a supercomputer does not have a keyboard like you would see on a piano. I was always kind of like...
She's not like any other computer you've ever seen, so of course she had to look different.
Yeah, Emmett definitely had a few things to do with that, because we find out later that he actually built Synergy. So the girls all learn that Synergy is this supercomputer that is awesome. These great holographic images, and she'll demonstrate this by shooting a beam of light at Kimber, changing Kimber into Aja, changing Aja into Kimber, and Shayna gets turned into Aja. And it's just one of the coolest tricks you actually see. And then, of course, another thing that you notice that you're revealed is all this music equipment. And what you don't learn early on is that all the girls are musically inclined. You know, they don't even really even make mention of that. And,
they all grew up knowing music, and I think that those instruments, I mean, there's no way Emmett could have known that they were going to form a band, but he gave them all this stuff that they could use for Starlight Music, and then, of course, the Rock and Roadster for their use.
And you can't actually ignore the real fashions that were created, too. I mean, we were talking like this whole, I mean, every woman would be just drooling over how much wardrobe these girls actually had. I mean, we're talking just about everything you can think of under the sun in this one storage locker, and it's just amazing. And it's the real clothes, and they, you know, then this is, of course, all playing off the fashions that were coming up for the doll line, and so they had to draw some of these in. And when we start talking about fashions later on, you're going to find out there's a lot of stuff that was released that was never in the show, and then vice versa. There was stuff in the show that was never released into real fashions for the dolls. So basically, once you're introduced to all the main characters throughout the series, the girls get this really great idea of basically introducing themselves in a song fashion. And what are they going to do? Well, they're going to go out and basically upstage the Misfits. Now, the Misfits
You can't forget about that bet that Jerrica and Eric already had. So they created KJEM so that they can get in and have a band to perform for that bet.
Right, right. But actually, even before that, the girls actually go on and kind of are, they kind of pull a Misfits, I think. They actually kind of pull a Misfits, and they actually go out there and start, you know, upstaging the Misfits. They actually put on a show, and they get everybody's attention, and, you know, they pan the camera around, and you can see the looks on Eric and Pizzazz and Roxy and Stormer's faces. They're, like, just bug-eyed, and their jaws are dropped because they've never heard this band before.
Yeah.
You know, because KJEM and the Holograms just totally rocks, and you can't deny talent. So, magically, the girls can play. They have these great fashions, and, of course, Eric is absolutely enraged. He's absolutely irritated. He's literally saying, "You can't play here. You know, get out of here." And of course, you know, a huge kind of like, I don't know, kind of a battle of words types of kind of takes place. And one thing leads to another where, you know, Jerrica's or KJEM is like, "Oh, yeah, she invited us." And of course, she magically produces Jerrica as a hologram. And then, of course, KJEM disappears. Jerrica takes over, steps up to Raymond, and, you know, basically gives him an earful and says, "Look, I don't like rigged contests, okay?" Because essentially the Misfits are going to play a concert that was going to completely, you know, they're going to get the cheesiest bands in the world. You got the Cadets, you got the Limp Lizards, you got the Leatherettes, who all pretty much are horrible rock bands, okay? And, I mean, no offense to them.
And that was done on purpose so that the Misfits could win.
And you can see, fans, ladies and gentlemen, that is exactly what a rigged contest is. You get the worst bands in the battle of the bands, and then, of course, what do? You pick the number one band to actually win. So, Jerrica's like, "I don't like rigged contests." And Eric's like, he doesn't really hesitate for a moment. He kind of says, "All right, if you think you're so hot, in 6 months, I'll make the Misfits the number one band ever." You know, and basically calling this really interesting bet. And what he's going to do is he's going to bet that his band can be better than anybody else. And if his band wins, he's going to claim Starlight Music as his own. And Jerrica, if her band wins, she gets to keep Starlight Music, and he'll, you know, supposedly graciously bow out, but of course that would be the end of the series, and then who would want that? So Jerrica agrees to the bet, and then this random character of Howard Sands just happens to be in this park and happens to have a movie, you know, he's a movie director, and he's like, "All right, I'll sweeten the pot here. I'll throw in a movie deal for you guys. You know, so whoever wins gets that, and they actually get another mansion." Okay, which obviously, if you guys know the show, you know how that's going to play out later on. So you have this battle of the bands. You have a movie contract, and you have pretty much the first episode with some of those little acts or whatever. Then what you end up having is this nice little Misfits moment where they decide, "You know what? We don't like you guys, so we're going to go steal your equipment," which I find so random. It's like, really, would you seriously walk off with like a $1,000 keyboard? Just run off with a keyboard? You know?
They would.
Would you run off with a bunch of guitars? Yeah, they would. That's very true. But I have to admit, though, when I watched this episode, I watched it tonight, and I'm thinking to myself, okay, seriously, you really want to steal a bunch of equipment? I mean, I guess it just seems like
the consequences. They just act. You know how Pizzazz just gets an idea and goes with it. She's not thinking about what's going to happen. She just wants to do something to get back at the Holograms.
Exactly, because she was upstaged, and, you know, as we all know, pizzazz does not like to be upstaged. By the way, if you listeners are still interested in calling in, don't forget that you can. Our number is 1-724-444-7444. Our call-in ID number is 93860. So as the Misfits steal the Gem and Holograms music equipment, a nice big chase scene starts. You know, and this, of course, is for the action for the boys. When they take off, this, I think, is kind of cheesy because it literally turns into a real cliffhanger, and there's no pun intended here. There's literally a cliffhanger.
Literally
a cliff. Exactly. First of all, the girls, I mean, Pizzazz and Roxy and Stormer, they're all in their really cool Misfits van, and they're chucking the instruments out at the girls in the Rockin' Roadster, and essentially it's a road distraction. They go driving off, literally almost off a cliff. And then the next commercial begins. I still find this, and I know Christy made this comment in the audio commentary. She's like, I really wanted to make a visual representation of a cliffhanger. So there's your cliffhanger. And I just thought that was kind of like, really? You had to do that? Okay, fine. So, but back in those days, you know, again, when it was kids watching it, that was like the, you know, oh, what's going to happen now?
Oh, that was exciting. I liked it.
Yeah, it really was. So then in the final act, Act 3, there had to be a way of getting out of the situation. So Jerrica,
luckily
basically,
for them, they had those earrings that could project holograms. And, oh, by the way, sound, too. So project a hologram, get Rio's attention.
Exactly. Yeah, you got to get Rio's attention. You got to do that. And, of course, he rescues him. He's the hero of the day. But guess what happens? Eric is not a happy camper. Eric is really annoyed by this. And he's like, great, thanks a lot, girls, for giving these guys probably $1 million worth of free publicity. And, of course, this is one of those things where the Misfits are like, you know what, who cares, we're better than them, and we can do whatever we want. And this breaks into their music video of Winning is Everything, which is probably, I think, one of the coolest songs written because it's got such a great syncopation or whatever, but we won't go into the music side of it. And, you know, with this whole attitude of, you know, we're going to basically conquer the world and winning is everything. We don't care who gets hurt. You know, too bad. So sad. And, you know, basically that's kind of how their little montage goes with all their videos. It's, you know, it's all about selfishness. It's about greed. It's about we're everything. We're everything in a box of crackers, you know.
So, the center of the universe.
So, you know, one of the things I always found that was really interesting was how long it took them to introduce the Starlight Girls, because they're not introduced until the third act. And the Starlight Girls are, you know, basically the foster girls. These are the girls that pretty much, you know, had no place else to go, lost their parents.
That are at the foster home that Jackie and Emmett started way back when with getting Aja and Shayna. And they ended up, I think there was 12 Starlight Girls there at one time. So they ended
there
up
was
with
at one point.
And then they started introducing them in this first episode.
One of the girls that you are introduced to is probably the brattiest of all the girls, and that's Ashley Larson. Now, interestingly enough, this is back when apparently Ashley was a brat. And,
at first,
you know, she was brown-eyed, too. Now, you find out later on in later episodes that she became blue-eyed, so she's got contacts or had eye surgery. She had an eye transplant or something. I don't know what it was, but geez, you know, I mean, that's just funny. And then her attitude changed, too. She became a really good girl as opposed to this bratty girl, so I don't know if that was like some person said.
I think maybe dealing with the Misfits gave her a change of heart. That's the way I'll explain it, anyway.
Change of heart's a later episode, so. But,
no, not that episode.
No, exactly.
Change of attitude.
Exactly. So what they're trying to do is raise money for the Starlight Mansion. I'm not trying to raise money for the Starlight Mansion. They're trying to raise money for a new refrigerator for Starlight Mansion. And they need a whole bunch of money. And they're down to about $30 that they need. And, of course, Brady Ashley's like, why do I even care about this? Why are we even doing this? Blah, 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 being a little drama queen. And, of course, they're like, you know what, just try to raise some money. Come on, just go out and do it, you know. And she's like, I don't care, whatever. And, you know, essentially, Ashley, to me, is just this little brat that you just kind of want to smack upside the head sometimes because she's like, how can you be that bratty? Well, anyway.
She gets the brilliant idea to try and steal some of that money, and she gets caught red-handed. And what I really like, though, about when they catch her, I really like the form of parenting Jerrica chooses, which is, you know, oh, I'm not going to do anything. You cannot lie and steal and live here, so we're going to let the other girls decide what to do with you. I like that. That's fitting.
Dun, dun, da. Exactly.
Yeah.
And that was one of the funniest things too. And then of course you hear this, okay, fine. You gotta raise $30. And she's like, where am I gonna get $30 from? Well, you know what, we don't care. Just go get the money. So then we're kind of introduced to another character. So what you guys have to notice about this first episode, there's a lot of bouncing around. There's a lot of bouncing around with characters and scenes and all this stuff. So, you know, because you only had so much time to actually fit all this into an episode. So the next really interesting character is Zipper. And I believe it's not one of Christie's favorite characters either.
Yeah.
Zipper is one of these really cheesy 80s thugs. And I don't even call him a thug. He's more of an idiot, okay?
He is an idiot. What kind of a moron? I've got to say, what kind of a moron breaks into a house and gets caught and is wearing a jacket with their own name on it? He really is an idiot.
Yeah, he really is. And he's got the cheesiest sunglasses on, too, and the cheesiest hairstyle. But, you know, that was the look back then, but whatever. You know, it looks like he was kind of a throwback to the 50s, I suppose. So, you know, Zipper ends up breaking in the house. And,
yeah, with his name on his jacket.
With his name on his jacket, exactly. And lo and behold, little Chrissy hears all the commotion going downstairs.
Oh,
and
no,
she
that's
wakes
Marianne.
Up.
That's Marianne.
Oh, that's Marianne? Okay.
Yeah.
See, I don't even get the characters right. That's why I have a good host.
She woke up Jerrica, and then they caught Zipper, and the idiot starts a fire, and there goes Twilight House.
Well, no, not quite yet. Not only does he start a fire, but first of all, why is Kimber carrying a lantern? Why would you have a lantern? Yeah, I understand that, but why a lantern? Why not a flashlight? I mean, they didn't live in the 1700s where there was no electricity.
That's got to just be what she grabbed.
Yeah, I suppose. I suppose. I guess I gotta give props to that. I suppose there would be no Starlight House and wouldn't be a Starlight Mansion for them to move into later on if the house didn't burn to the ground.
To see that house go, though. That was a cool house, even if it was old.
It was a Victorian mansion, absolutely, and
yes.
I am partial to Victorian mansions. So
me
anyway,
too. Love it.
But ladies and gentlemen, that's actually the end of the very first episode. You know, a lot of it was just exposition, a lot of it was introductions, a lot of it was just, you know, a little bit of fun, a little bit of drama, and pretty much just really kind of getting every character out there so we all knew what to expect. I think that the next four episodes are a little more interesting because now we've gotten past all the, you know, all the introductions, everybody kind of knows who everybody is. My final thought on this whole thing is that it's a really cool show. I have to admit, totally original concept to actually have a rock band. And actually,
yeah,
two rock bands, no less. You have two really cool rock bands that made some really creative music. And, you know, you only get to hear, three songs, I believe, in the first one. You have Only the Beginning, you have The Misfits Winning Is Everything, and then I think there's one more at the end, which I forget.
Out of My Way.
Thank you. Yeah. So Misfits got two songs. So not only do they get the opening title song, but then they get two more songs in addition to that. It's really interesting how it played out.
Okay, the Misfits have fans too, you know?
The Misfits do have fans, yeah. They're an uber group. They're a super group. You know, maybe not at the time, but I think they were pretty famous at that point. You know, and I guess, like I said, one of the things about the episode too was that, you know, you really got introduced to some really pivotal characters. You know, like I said earlier, the way they drew it out, you know, was pretty amazing. They already had the character traits already there for the most part. Some things were still being ironed out. But, you know, it was really, really cool. It's one of those things where when I watch the show again, yes, it's hard to get over some of the animation, I have to admit, and some of the vocal flubs where you see Kimber talking out of Aja's mouth and Shayna's mouth or whatever, and it's like, really? So, you know, and that's fine. I mean, you can overlook that stuff. And then, of course, the really weird hairstyles that were, like, so boxy and so chopped up and didn't look right. But, you know, it was before the big hair.
At the beginning.
I didn't like how Jerrica looked, no.
Yeah.
No, she was very off-model. She was very off-model. And, you know, it's about like where the Simpsons were when they were on the Tracy Ullman show. Very off-model, freakish looking. But thank goodness they corrected all of that later on, and it wasn't too many episodes later where that was fixed up. Well, anyway, folks, we're out of time tonight, and we wanted to thank everybody who called in, and wanted to say thank you to all of you who are listening, and to let you know that our show will be posted in about 24 hours. And this is Craig Phillips.
And Amy Rose.
And we both want to wish you a great night, and see you next week. Bye.
Bye.